Really cool how everything's relative.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, breaks your head.
I don't know what happened. I was with someone the other night.
Well, you weren't the only one, since I looked earlier. I said it had 3 views, so.
I was one.
I watched it.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
Confidence intervals?
Really watch it, because yeah. It's about confidence intervals.
Yeah, there was. You can watch it after
class. That might actually help me.
I know, I forgot all about this one.
I just said it in class.
I'll end up watching it
now, for sure. I like your typo.
My typo? Mm-hmm. I don't remember what it was, but sure.
EST major. Like
10 seconds,
point out that it was a typo
if they ignored
it.
Oh, sure.
That's like a funny hat.
What? I have a hat. What?
Hey, Dr. Joe.
Yes.
Are you a big Star Wars fan?
Not particularly. Why?
Have you seen Star Wars?
I saw the first 3 when I was, growing up, and then I saw the first one, which I guess is the fourth one, or the fourth one, which is the first one, whatever
you
the
heck. You haven't seen all of them.
Oh, gosh, no.
And that's just funny. But anyway.
I don't watch very many movies.
For those of you who have, and like never thought of this, and thought anything of it, when you shoot the Star Destroyers down, they go down, but they're in space, so they didn't even go anywhere. I noticed this a little bit ago, and I was like, how has nobody brought this up?
Well, if they're in orbit around the planet, and they need the power to be in orbit around the planet, and then they don't have the power anymore, the planet could be drawing them towards the planet.
They're in the middle of space.
But they could go up
there. Well, depending on what part of the planet they're on, sure.
Suppose if you hit them on top, then the momentum...
You could do that, too, yeah.
Fair point. It just bothered me, because like, nobody ever thought about this. It's like, oh, it's broken, so it's going to fall.
Maybe the way they explode, the force of the explosion...
I'll do research.
I don't know if I've seen Star Wars.
All right.
I saw the first one at a drive-in theater.
That's why.
I love
it. Dr. Joe.
Yes.
Yeah.
I went to his house one night, and their dog freaking loves me. Can I show you the video?
I had to find it too.
Can we start class?
But it'll be really fast.
I want to talk about maximum likelihood estimated.
I don't care what you're doing. It'll be really fast. I'll show you later.
You can show me later. I would like to see it later. All right. Do we have questions about class?
No, because I didn't watch the video, Dr. Joe, so I wouldn't know.
Well, we're still talking about maximum likelihood estimator stuff, too. So, do you have any questions about that?
Is there a minimum likelihood function?
Does
no.
No.
Yes, Sam.
So for every one of these, is it just always
Are they like
no.
10 parts?
Because like the KMAX form is
was 1 over the mean.
Yeah, I didn't have
it was 1 over the mean to get the probability, right? Because you're 5
yeah. Yeah. All
right. Other questions? Are we okay with the process for finding them using the likelihood functions?
I think so.
Okay. Well, that's good. Now, for video purposes, I did post 2 more examples as well, going through those things.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
Those should be on YouTube as well.
The YouTubes,
yes.
Yeah, YouTube.
Like the Twitters.
And like the maths.
The maths, yes.
Okay.
That's British. Yeah, it's very British.
Math, not math.
Maths.
They say the maths.
Yeah, they do. The maths.
I don't. It's really weird.
Yeah. Well, it doesn't matter. Math is an abbreviation anyway, so.
It's a mathematics.
It's mathematics, yeah.
It's just a different way to abbreviate
it. Yeah, it's just a different way to abbreviate it, exactly. So, all right. So right at the end of class last time, we talked about biased and unbiased estimators. So in particular, just to write out the definition, is if theta hat is an estimator for theta, and the expected value of theta hat gives you theta, then theta hat is an unbiased estimator. So we've had a couple of different examples of... That is one ugly hat.
Well, that was rude, don't you think?
Well, I'm the one who drew it.
Well, that hat has feelings to that theta.
It does? Really? It does. Okay. I can eliminate its feelings with one stroke. All right. So just as some examples, when we use the S squared, the sample variance, we went through and calculated that the expected value of the sample variance really is the population variance. So S squared is an unbiased estimator. However, in the example that we did at the end of class last time, when you had when we had the random variable that was uniform on zero theta, we said that our theta hat, our maximum likelihood estimator, the maximum we said that the expected value, and I never did actually go look it up to make sure I was right. I'm going to pretend like I am. It's a fraction of theta, but it'll get closer and closer as n goes to infinity, so that's what that does. That n minus 1 over n might be wrong, but we could calculate it just by finding the mean of the distribution of a maximum of random independent and identically distributed random variables. You go through and calculate it. Remember how we did the Wow, that's really shaking. Remember how we did the PDF for this? Just as a reminder. How we did the PDF for the maximum of random variables. You remember that from last semester?
Oh, last semester. Yeah. It was that, long.
So, just to review that, for a minute. All right, so let's say we had let y be that. So I want the maximum to be less than or equal to y. In order for the maximum to be less than or equal to a value, what has to be true?
Say it again.
In order for the maximum of a list of numbers to be less than or equal to y, what has to be true? If I have a whole string of numbers and I want to make sure that the maximum of the string of numbers is less than or equal to y, what has to be true? What has to be true about the individual ones? Yeah, they're each less than or equal to y, right? Right? And if we assume that they're independent and they're identically distributed, this is an and statement now, right? All are less than or equal to y. So how can we break up a and statement? Multiplication, right? So this is the product that probably that a particular x sub I is less than or equal to y, right? We agree? Yeah? Which means it's the product of each of the individual cumulative distribution functions. If I use that as f to describe the cumulative distribution function for an x, then it's the product of each of those. But notice that this doesn't depend on I because they're identically distributed. It's all the same distribution function. So this just turns out to be capital F of y. Oops. To the n. Does this look familiar from last semester? Okay. So if I want the PDF then, this was the CDF. If I want the PDF, we take the derivative. Which chain rule gives us that, correct? Yeah. Okay. So I could figure from this particular problem, I can figure out what the mean of this is. Right? Multiply it by y and just calculate it. So it might be n over n plus 1 now that I say that, but figure it out. So this is a unit, each of these in this particular example, each is a uniform distribution, right? So its PDF was what? We were on uniform on 0 to theta, so its PDF is 1 over theta, right? What would its CDF be then? That was a derivative. We would integrate with respect to theta. We'd integrate with respect to x, because theta is a fixed parameter. It's just x over theta, right? Because you're going from 0 to theta. So for our purposes, for this example, we would have n times x over theta to the n minus 1 times 1 over theta.
Is that for this specific problem?
That's for this specific example, yes. So, and in particular, I would have, a theta hat here, but that's all right. So, if I want the mean then, how would I find the expected value? I guess technically I would want a y here instead of an x. Sorry. So that was wrote in terms of y to start with. If I want the expected value, what would we do? Okay. So do what?
Summer.
Well, it's continuous. So
oh, no, you take the... integrate.
Integrate it from...
by
0 to theta, right? And multiply it by...
Y.
Good. All right. So I would have... oh, goodness.
I have the foundation done. I'm pretty happy with that.
Yeah, it's not n minus 1 over n now that I see this. So we'll have a theta n over theta to the n, yes? Right? And if I multiply this by y, I'm going to get a y to the n. So I just split up the n minus 1 over the fraction. So that's where the theta to the n minus 1 times theta will give me theta to the n. And then I'll get y to the n because I have to multiply this by a y. When I do expected value, we take y times the PDF. So that's where the y to the n comes from.
So we're doing expected value of y.
Right now. Yep. Yeah, no worries.
So for this problem, how do we know that PDF is 1 over?
Because for this problem, we said that it was uniform on 0 to theta. So this is why I know that my formula is wrong, because I know what the integral is going to try to be at this point. Because I get n over n plus 1 times 1 over theta to the n times y to the n plus 1.
You just memorize all the stuff before you go to class.
I just integrated y to the n.
I know, I just made it.
What do you mean, do I memorize the stuff?
Like you said... I'll bring it up again when it happens, rather than trying to waste my
free time. Well, I wrote down the formula at the end of class last time that I thought was correct, and it wasn't. I was off by one on top and bottom for the. So I'll have to go back and correct it.
So it's not.
It's not n minus one over n. It's you'll figure out. Well, you can see what it's going to be here in a second.
Where did I write it down?
Well, if I put in 0 for y, we definitely get 0. When I put in theta in for y, what do we get?
Theta plus
1. Yep, so I get n over n plus 1 times theta, which is why my number in front is wrong. So if I go back up here, where I wrote this n minus 1 over n, it's off by 1 on top and bottom. I made a boo-boo. N over n plus 1. So it's also wrong at the end of your notes from last time, too. I even mentioned last time that I wasn't 100% certain that was right. It was Friday, the 29th. Yeah, it should just be right above where, it should be right above today, if you go in order. I didn't want to be wrong, I didn't want it to be wrong in your notes. And I meant to do this before I came to class to tell you to correct it. But, it was a good review.
Got it.
That was a good review for going through things from Last and Oscar. All right, anyway, the idea of this being, the whole reason why I went through this is because this tells me that we're using the maximum likelihood estimator here, it's biased. Because I didn't just get theta. It depends on the n. Okay? So on average, the smaller the n is, the worse your estimate will be, but without having to adjust it. Okay? That's the idea.
So what's
biased in this case? The estimator is biased. The theta hat. The maximum likelihood estimator here is biased. And it's actually the first example that we've come up with that where the maximum likelihood estimator here is biased. Every one of the other ones we've done so far have all been unbiased, if you check them.
And that's just for this problem?
Correct. That is just for this problem, yes. Yeah, Alex?
So when it says it's biased, it just means that because you're using what the maximum likelihood estimator is, slightly lower than what would be the point.
It could be lower or it could be higher. It's off. Yeah, on average, it's off.
Yeah. So skews the data a little bit.
Yeah. But in this case, I mean, we know we would need to adjust it to make it unbiased, but it's not just a constant because it changes by what the sample size would be.
Right.
If it were just a number, then you could just put the number. In this case, you would always have to change what the constant is to be able to do it. All right.
Maximum likelihood estimators are not the only way to get estimators. So for this particular example, another way to get estimators would be using what's referred to as method of moments. All right. So we talk about a method of moments estimator. Remember, your first moment is just the mean, the second moment is the expected value of x squared, and third moment is expected value of x cubed, and so on the line, right? So your variance for your distribution depends on your second moment, but your mean really is the first moment. So the idea behind the method of moments estimators is to figure out from what you know the expected value should be for a particular population, what should I use for the estimator to make it equal to that? So what I mean for that is, what if we go back, let's just do this with an example. I'm not saying it very well, so let's just do the example. Hopefully it'll make sense. Oops. Because if not, then shoot. Yeah, pretty much. Or something stronger.
I didn't want to say something stronger.
All right, so let's say that x is uniform on 0 to infinity. What is, at 0 to theta, thank you. What is expected value of x in this case? It's a uniform distribution. Yeah, well, that's why I'm asking. What's it? What is it? It should be theta over 2, right? A plus B over 2? Hey! All right. This is the theoretical expected value, right? If I know that it's uniform on 0 to infinity, or 0, jeez, 0 to theta, then words are hard. Then the expected value of x should be theta over 2, right? So if I have a random sample, I also know how I calculate an expected value. I would just take, add them up, and divide by how many there are, correct? And we call that the x bar. So for the method of moments, if I want to get an estimator based on the moment, I would set the expected value equal to the sample mean. This is population mean. This is sample mean. I set the two equal to each other. Can I solve for theta?
No.
Yeah. Yeah, so theta, your estimator, so your theta hat in this case would be 2 times the sample mean.
So theta and theta hat are the same thing?
Theta hat is your value that you're using to estimate theta. Theta is the population parameter. Theta hat is your best guess at what that population parameter is. So the reason why you use the hat is because you're saying it's an estimated value. the theta, if you actually knew what theta was, there would be no point in estimating it. So the reason why you use the hat is to differentiate the fact that, no, I'm using an estimate for this value. I don't know the true value. Yeah.
Did you say the X bar is the population?
X bar is the sample mean. It's a little x. It's a small x. The theta over 2 is the population mean. Yeah, Grace.
So the theta over 2, or any distribution that we did last semester, the mean is the population mean?
Yes. Yeah, what we did last semester was all about trying to figure out the characteristics of the population. What we're going to be all about this semester is how do we estimate those characteristics of the population? Which is why, in some sense, this semester is probably going to be a little bit easier because we're not going to have to go back and reinvent all that stuff.
So when you say that, you're just basically saying it's like last semester, we're just given everything as it's like an
edible. Yep. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so now is what happens when it's imperfect. And then you can, it's the farther along you go with statistics, the more you assume things are imperfect. For example, one thing we will not work with, but is something that's a big deal that I know that Dr. Lee works with, is the idea of censored data where you don't have the exact value. You might know something about it, but not exactly what it is.
Well, yeah.
Just telling you, that's another thing that pops up in statistics.
I still get nervous.
Why do you get nervous? If you're gonna whip it at me and I don't feel comfortable, I'll just move.
Okay. It'll just hit the wall.
I'll just move. All right. So in this particular case, one of the reasons why I did this one first is notice that your method of moment estimator here is different than the maximum likelihood estimator. Right? The maximum likelihood estimator for this example was the maximum of the things in the sample. The method of moment estimator is 2 times the mean of the sample.
So these are just different. You're using one or the other. Right?
Correct. Yeah. Now, in lots and lots and lots of cases, they're equal.
The method of moment and the maximum likelihood function equal sometimes.
But at most of the
time. Most.
Yeah. for the distributions that we study, for most of them are equal to each other. Okay. So as an example, we talked about the geometric when we did the, if you had your f of x is 1 minus p to the x minus 1 times p, that's geometric. And we came up with p hat was 1 over the sample mean. That was what our maximum likelihood estimator was, right? Might have been the video, sure. Do you want to go through it? I mean, I can go through it real quick, but...
I'm not sure, but
we can also see pretty quickly that this is also the method of moments estimator. Because if I do expected value of x, what do we know the expected value is for a geometric distribution? 1 over p, right? So if we do the same thing that we just did in the previous example with setting this equal to x bar and solve, we get the same thing. If you go through exponential distribution, for example, you will get that the maximum likelihood estimator for theta is the mean. And what is the mean of an exponential distribution? Theta, right? So they really are equal to each other. In pretty much all of your the distributions that you learned, the maximum, especially for one variable, the maximum likelihood estimator is the same as the method of moments estimator. Yes, Grace.
Does that mean anything special? Like, is there anything
special? It means that you don't have to go through all of the work to find the maximum likelihood estimator if you know that it really is the same as the method of moments. If you know from a theoretical standpoint, if you're trying to use it for a problem, for example, nope. I don't have one on here.
Did you get the tables back up here?
No. I don't need them yet, so I know I haven't. I do have the tea table on here, though, now. I don't have one on here. Let's see. Do I have that saved on here? Nope, that's not what I wanted to open. Go away. I thought I had one already saved, so... I know. It's fun, isn't it? So to say, you have a lot to look forward to, don't you?
Is that what that is?
Yeah, this is actually this is another actuarial exam. A different one. Not exam P. This is exam S. Yes.
Is that the fourth one?
Third one? All right, here we go. So this actually tells you. So this says that here are a whole bunch of them that are... The maximum likelihood estimates is the same as the method of moment estimates. So, if you come across a problem where it asks you for one of these, you know right away that you don't have to go through the maximizing the likelihood function to find the maximum likelihood estimator. You already know this is the method of moments estimator, which is much easier to find. Because you know what the mean of the distribution is, and you just set it equal to the sample mean and solve for the parameter. Makes life much simpler. From a problem solving standpoint. So, for example,
Dr. Joe, can I take a picture of that with you?
That one? You're welcome.
So, it doesn't have geometric on there?
Geometric is negative binomial. R would be one.
Oh, okay.
Yep. So, for example, if I can find one here real quick, here we go. So here's one that says it was a Poisson distribution is fitted. Since it tells me it's Poisson, I need to know which parameter. I need to know lambda, right? What's the mean of a Poisson equal to in terms of its parameter? Lambda. So since I know it's Poisson, I just know I need to do a mean for this. Calculate the mean of the sample. And then use it for my lambda to answer the question. You want to see it real quick?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me. Video, you can watch it for Monday because I'm not probably going to talk about confidence intervals today. I'm looking at the time. By the way, if you hear an alarm go off in my pocket, it's because I set my alarm on my phone for 11:48 for Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays to make sure that I can let you out at 11:50. So if you happen to hear the alarm... Well, I know that you guys have to walk across over to Scoville. And,
yeah, it's... Yeah, there's literally just like...
Really? Across. You can't paste content. I think you are a lying sack of...
Shit.
I didn't say that.
Yeah, I did. Why don't you just use the snipping tool?
Yeah, just snip
yeah.
Oh, for heaven's sake, people. Stop being so technologically advanced.
You can snip it in OneNote.
You can also press the window button.
I can share it.
Yeah, RW. No, it's
or you can press Alt-Shift-4 to drag it.
I hope at this point you guys are just making up things.
No,
no, mine was serious.
I know some of you were serious, but I don't like that going.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
It was like a lot of
if you go to the insert, you can go there.
Could I just do it here?
S-E-Q-4 at the same time.
You get the snippy action.
Need to go away because I need to get that blue off of there. Hey, what are you doing? Cancel. New. There we go. All I was trying to do is get this over here. I do the take a snapshot and it automatically puts a copy and I just paste it. I don't know why it's not doing it. No, that's how I do them, all of them. I don't have an answer. There we go. We are experiencing technical difficulties. Please stand by. I needed some funky intermission music, some Muzak or something playing in the background while I was trying to get that to work. And what I should have put up on the screen was something like the test pattern, you know, like the red, the blue, the green. You're not familiar with that from, I'm the old. TVs would go off, television channels would go off the air at night. And for 8 hours of the evening, it would just have a color spectrum across the screen. Well, ESPN used to, its satellite signal would have to reset every once in a while. So they'd be talking, all of a sudden go bloop, and then it would keep talking. You don't know how good you have it. I was teasing. Heck, I remember not having a remote control.
Get up and
go up and turn the dial on the television. Now televisions don't even have dials.
Some don't even have buttons. Yeah.
Oh, the stupid, we bought a Samsung and the stupid remote is way too complicated because it doesn't have any buttons on it. It's move things around and, you know, spin on the spinner.
Yeah, you can like type.
Yeah, I hate it. All right. So what we're saying is that the data are going to be fitted using maximum likelihood. I believe the example that I did in the video will show you that the maximum likelihood estimator was the mean, right? And the method of moments estimator here would also be the mean. Because you know that for Poisson, your expected value is lambda. And for method of moments, you would set that equal to x bar, and you'd be done, right? There's nothing to solve, like just set them equal to each other. This is your population theoretical mean. This is the mean you got from the sample. So you would just use that as your theoretical mean and use that for calculation purposes, right? So if I want to know what lambda is, I need to calculate the mean of the sample. What's wrong, Megan?
The
x-bar is your sample mean. Yep. So if I want to calculate the mean of the sample, I would do how many things are in the sample. Let's see. It's 520 plus 195, 57, 22, 5, and 1. So there's 800 things in the sample. I just added up the right column. And then for the top, I would need to do a weighted average. So I would need to do the 195 plus 2 times 57 plus 3 times 22 plus 4 times 5 plus 5 times 1. Everybody see why I'm doing that? I'm trying to add up the values that you got. Right? There's 195 ones, 57 twos, 22 threes, 5 fours, and a 5. Okay. So if I do that, times 3 times, 4 times, and a 5, on top you should get 400. So you get a half. By the way, does that number kind of jive with what you expect it to be given the things that are coming out of the distribution? Well, what's the most likely thing to have happened here?
Zero.
Yeah, the zero is happening, right? Right? That's the most likely thing to have happened is the zero. And so then we would expect the lambda to be small. If that's true, right? Because that should have the highest probability. All right, so when it's saying to determine the estimated probability of no claims, this is now the value you're going to use for your PDF of your Poisson distribution and just calculate a probability. So the probability that you have no claims is, well, your PDF is what? It's 1/2 to the 0. E to the minus 1/2 over 0 factorial. That's the Poisson, correct? Using the 1/2 for your lambda. So we get e to the minus 1/2. What's that?
Would it be one half to the negative one half?
That's one half to the zero. I know. 6065, that is ugly. 6065. So this is the point of this, by the way. There is a point. This is the point of this. So why would you want to do this particular type of estimation? I have some distribution. I have no real handle on what it is, but I do suspect that by nature it must be a Poisson distribution. Again, the idea of thinking of arrivals in a certain amount of time period, right? We would expect that kind of situation to have a Poisson distribution. So we want for it to have a Poisson distribution, I need to know its lambda. What's my best guess for you, a plausible lambda? Well, my best guess is using the sample mean, because lambda is the mean of the distribution. So my best plausible guess that I can use for the lambda is the sample mean. So I compute the sample mean, and then I want to start trying to make some inferences. Now, one of the things that we're going to do later this semester is, given this data, does it even make sense to try a Poisson distribution on it? Those are called goodness of fit tests that we'll do later on, where we'll use Excel. Okay. So it won't be a lot of calculations by hand, but it'll be a nice little process we can do in Excel. So that would be your first step. You have this data collected and say, okay, I think this might be a Poisson distribution. Let's check. So you do this goodness of fit test to say, is a Poisson distribution a good fit or not? And if the answer is yes, then you would say, okay, well, then what's my best guess going to be for the parameter? My best guess for the parameter is, I'll use my sample mean. And then I can start making inferences about the population as a whole. In this case, the inference is what I'm trying to figure out. What's the probability that we have no claims? That's the inference in this case. But if I'm going to make inferences based on a whole population, I need something to use for the lambda. So that's the idea behind this. I mean, it's a very simplified version of it, but that's the idea behind it. Yeah, Grace.
So if this wasn't a Poisson distribution or any of the six distributions that we could have used, we would have had to go through
Yeah, she would have had to go through the likelihood function idea.
Yeah. Well,
yep. Yep. Right. This okay? Yeah, Morgan.
So like what we did last time with the expected value of the theta hat, so is that different than what we found with the theta hat equals 2 times the?
Nope, this is the same thing. We just didn't have to solve for lambda. So I could write this as lambda hat. In this case, because the lambda hat that you get or the theta hat that you get is obtained by setting your theoretical mean equal to the sample mean and solving for the parameter. There's just nothing to solve here. Yeah. So that's the idea. All right. So this method of moments estimate helps out even more when you have two parameters to try to estimate as opposed to one. For example, if we do the gamma distribution, this is actually an example in your text, but it's a good illustration of why we might want to use method of moments estimation over maximum likelihood estimation. So remember, your gamma distribution looks like what? It's x to the alpha minus 1, e to the minus x over theta over gamma of alpha theta to the alpha. That's your gamma distribution? Okay. Think about what would happen if I had a likelihood function here. Well, first, I've got to maximize a function of two variables, right? Because I would have to maximize the likelihood function with respect to both theta and alpha, right? Correct? Which means that you would have to use the techniques that you use in Cal 3 by taking partials, or Cal 2 or Cal 3, depending on when we do it, taking partials with respect to both variables, setting them both equal to zero, solving simultaneously, checking that that's a max or a min. Lots of fun stuff, right?
So much fun.
Cal 3 stuff?
Okay? Also notice that how do we get the likelihood function? We plug in the sample and do a product of things, right? Right? In particular, I have to do a product of this thing, this particular gamma function in there in particular, right? I'll have a bunch of gammas multiplied by itself, gamma of alphas multiplied by itself when I do that. And then I have to differentiate with respect to alpha. Remember, your gamma function is defined in terms of an integral where the alpha is on the inside of the integral, right? Gamma of alpha is the integral from 0 to infinity of x to the alpha minus 1 e to the minus x. Right? And then you have to differentiate. It's just a mess. Right? You're not going to want to do that, especially if you're going to do the log of it. So then you have the log of the gamma function, it's not going to be pretty to try to do it. Okay?
So maximum likelihood estimation on this function, on this PDF, is not really feasible. Okay? You'd have to use a bunch of numerical techniques to be able to do it. I mean, you can get at it. It's just not necessarily feasible. But the method of moments is easier for this one, right? What is the expected value of x here? For gamma, what is the expected value of x? Okay. Right? We also know the variance is what?
Theta squared. No, other way. Oh. Sorry. Alpha theta
squared. Good. Alpha theta squared. Is this the second moment?
No.
No. What is this?
That is the second moment minus.
Yeah, yeah. So this is the second moment minus the first moment squared, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. All right. So this would be your alpha theta squared. So your expected value of x squared would be alpha theta squared minus alpha theta quantity squared, right?
Why are you trying to find the second moment?
Well, I'll tell you in a minute. All right. How many variables do I need to solve for?
Two. So how many equations am I going to need?
Two.
I should be plus, shouldn't
yeah.
I? Thank you.
I saw Justin raise a hand. I'm like, something's wrong. Okay. All right.
Should be a plus. Thank you. All right. So I need two equations to solve for the two variables.
One of the equations is going to be set the theoretical mean to the sample mean, right? Right? Yeah. This is your first moment, correct? Or not a squared, but that's how we get it, isn't it? 1 over n times the sum of the x of i's, right? Okay. So
at least the way I think about it, to get the first moment, to get the sample mean, I'm adding up these individual things divided by n, or think about it from a probabilistic standpoint. I've got n things. If they're all equally likely, this would be the expected value, right? It's PDF times value, right? If there's n things from a discrete standpoint, we're doing the expected value, right? I would take it times its probability. The probability would be 1 over n if they're all equally likely, which is just a random sample, I'm just pulling things out. That's how I think about it. So the reason why I think about it that way is because it helps you with the second moment. The first moment, the power is 1. The second sample moment, so I would set my alpha theta squared minus, I'll write it as alpha squared theta squared, or plus, will be 1 over n times the sum of the squares of each of your x values. That's your second moment.
Why are you squaring the alpha?
Here? This one?
This alpha?
I just distributed the exponent.
Yeah, Maureen.
So how can you just square that side of the second?
Well, that's how we calculate the second moment from the sample.
Oh.
So that's what I was mentioning was, if I think of my random sample as a discrete distribution, then, and if I think it was a uniform discrete distribution, then its probability would be 1 over n. Mm-hmm. So this is how you would calculate the first moment, this is how you would calculate the second moment. Okay. So it's literally how we would calculate it. So now we should be able to figure out what theta and what alpha are, right? From solving a system of equations now, correct? I can solve the first one, say, for alpha, right? So the first one, this one says that alpha is equal to x bar over theta, right? So then you can plug it in over here. So you would have x bar over theta times theta squared, and then plus x bar squared over theta squared times theta squared equals the 1 over n sum of the x by squareds. Yep, see, there's my alarm. Okay. And then we can solve this for theta. Notice, conveniently, these theta squareds go away, don't they? So, and then this one will cancel one of those. So you've got x bar theta. I'm going to go ahead and move the x bar squared to the other side. And then divide by x bar. So that would be what your theta would be. Now, and then you can go back and figure out what alpha is, because that's not bad at this point. But look at the top. It looks super familiar, doesn't it? It looks like a variance idea, doesn't it? It's almost sample variance. It's close. It's almost sample variance, except that I would not have the one, n minus 1 piece, right? It's all over n. So your book actually refers to that. They give it, just so they can simplify some notation, they give it a V. They call it V. So this piece here, that's just a definition. But that's how we calculate it. If we had a discrete distribution, a uniform discrete distribution, it's exactly how we would calculate variance if we knew the whole population. But again, now that you have this, you can go back and figure out what alpha is, right? Okay. So this is one of the reasons why we like the method of moments estimation, is because of the fact that when we have something that's more difficult to calculate,